Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. I am so excited to be going back to the Rhone River later this October with kosher riverboat cruises. The region of Provence is just filled with Jewish history. There is a remarkable flourishing of Jewish culture and spirituality and literary ideas and thoughts. And oh my gosh, so many of the sages of Provence continue to inspire me. And one of the things I'd like to look at today with you is an interesting and unusual moment. An Aliyah of 300 rabbis from Provence, principally, in the year 1211. Aliyah, of course, refers to emigration to the land of Israel. That's a Hebrew word that means to ascend. Whenever a person decides to live in Israel permanently, that's called making Aliyah, making an ascent. And it's amazing to see such a large number of highly trained and respected leaders leaving Provence, which is a very beautiful part of the world, and going to the land of Israel, also a very beautiful part of the world. But, you know, don't get me wrong, in the 13th century, pretty dangerous and very difficult to actually, you know, make a living there under those circumstances. So what I'd like to do in this brief video is try to understand why exactly do they do it, and what do we know about this story? I'm going to rely on two articles in particular, both by extremely distinguished medievalists, Dr. Ephraim Carnefogel, who is from the northeastern part of the United States, up not too far from where I live. He wrote an article in 1986 called The Aliyah of 300 Rabbis in 1211, Tosafist Attitudes Towards Settling in the Lands of Israel. The term Tosafist, of course, refers to the fact that many of these great rabbis were members of the school of Tosafot. This is a very important Talmudic school that flourished around this time in France and in Germany, England, all the way out as far as Kiev, actually. And the other article is by Dr. Ram Ben Shalom, who in recent decades has been publishing some amazing, really, really fascinating work on Provencal Jewry in particular. His article is called The Messianic Journey of Jonathan HaKohen of Lunel, right, that's in the region we're talking about, to the land of Israel re-examined, and he published that in Mediterranean Historical Review in 2018. Those are the two main sources that we're going to look at. The locus classicus for this story, one of the most clear statements of the entire story, comes to us from a 16th century account called Shevet Yehuda, very important Sephardic work of history. And it goes like this. In the year 4791, which would correspond to 1211, God inspired the rabbis of France and England to go to Jerusalem. They numbered more than 300 and were accorded great honor by the king. They built for themselves synagogues and houses of study. Incidentally, Dr. Ben Shalom argues that that's in itself a polemic, saying, look, the Muslims allowed the Jews to build synagogues and houses of study, which they had difficulty doing at this time of the history in Western Europe. But anyway, back to the text. Our teacher, the great Kohen, Rabbi Jonathan of Lunel, went there as well. A miracle occurred. They prayed for rain and were answered, and the name of heaven was sanctified because of them. Okay, so that's typical kind of 16th century text. It's got some like sort of amazing, miraculous elements in it and so on. What do we make of this? What we can say for sure is that Jewish travelers to Jerusalem shortly after this event did confirm a presence of a large number of French rabbis in the city. And in fact, a very illustrious individual, Avraham ben Arambam, the son of Maimonides, also confirms this in the year 1235. So they're still there, you know, two decades later. And most significantly, a very important key Tosafot, member of the Bali Tosafot, Rabbi Samson of Sens, later called Man of Jerusalem, or the person from the land of Israel, because of his travel with this amazing Aliyah to Israel. We can estimate that there were two distinct waves of Aliyah, one from Provence specifically in 1209 or 1210 that arrived in time for Purim Jerusalem, and another one in 1211 that had more rabbis from northern France. Now, we can't take it necessarily exactly at face value. The specifics of this passage in the Shevet Yehuda, it was added by a later author and not necessarily known for being strict with the facts. There's some, you know, typical sort of, you know, inflation of numbers, because it's unlikely that there were even 300 Tosafists total that we know of in Europe at this time. To imagine that 300 of them left and still there are plenty left behind. So these numbers are hard to take, but nevertheless, there's no question that a significant number of leading rabbis all left Europe and made their way to Israel, where they had a significant impact as well. So let's try to understand, why did they leave? So this story has been well known for hundreds of years, and many historians have had a stab at it. If we go sort of chronologically, Samuel Krauss, very important Hungarian historian of the Jewish people, argued, somewhat fancifully perhaps, his thesis was heavily criticized, that the Jews of Provence left to go to Israel specifically to rediscuss the Maimonidean controversy, right? Maimonides was heavily condemned in parts of Europe. Provence was one of the first places where the controversy erupted. And in fact, as a result of the controversy, Maimonides' own books were burned in 1232 at the behest of Jewish communities, but burned by the Dominican friars. Terrible, terrible story. So Dr. Krauss argued that the Provençal scholars all went to Israel to re-argue the Maimonidean controversy and perhaps even to present apologies to Maimonides at his grave. Kind of an interesting thesis, but hard to really believe because, you know, the Maimonidean controversy did not really get rolling until a little bit later, and maybe he's reading it backwards. Famous scholar Elkan Nathan Adler wrote that, you know, at its heart, it was really messianism. And although this thesis didn't get a lot of support when he first promulgated it, Dr. Ben Shalom has really investigated further and said there's quite a bit to say about this. So we're going to return to messianism. Ephraim Urbach went to the go-to answer, anti-Semitism, right? When we don't know why something happens, it's either money or second choice, possibly anti-Semitism. And in fact, there's a lot to rely on at this point. Although the Jews were not expelled from Provence, there was a very abrupt and frightening expulsion in 1182 from other parts of France. And it's not hard to point to many things, the rise of Pope Innocent III, for example, that were indicating that at the beginning of the 13th century, there were a lot of really negative things for Jews and a lot of good reasons to leave Europe. But it doesn't answer the question, why specifically rabbis? I mean, you would think there would be a popular movement, not just rabbis. We'll come back to that. Robert Chazen argued, a really good answer, economic discrimination, and he pointed very carefully to some additional anti-Semitic taxes that were laid on the Jewish community in Provence and elsewhere at the beginning of the 13th century. Good reasons to leave, but if you're going to leave, why go to Israel, which was a very, very difficult journey? It was under a completely different political environment. It was threatened by warfare with the Crusades. You know, many Jews, if it was only economic in nature, they would have chosen perhaps to move to the East. And in fact, we will see a very large movement of Jews to the East a little bit later in this period of time, where it was easier to make a living than it was going to Israel. Finally, Dr. Carnefogel, who wrote the article in 1986, he argued quite simply that it was an expression of piety. It was an expression of engagement with the Talmudic text, which is what the Bali Tosfot were all about, that made them see over and over again how incredibly important it was to make Aliyah, to move to the land of Israel. And that makes a lot of sense, especially when we see how so many of the sources seem to emphasize the fact that this was not a popular movement. This was something that came primarily from those experts in the Talmud, the Bali Tosfos. Just the ongoing connection with the ideas expressed in the Talmud said to these rabbis, you know what? We really should be moving to Israel. And Dr. Carnefogel brings a lot of very, very convincing arguments from the writings of these Bali Tosfos to indicate that, yeah, they're moving ineluctably to this religious conclusion. Now, let us just ask one question here. Why Provence? Why specifically that part of the world? Now, it's especially interesting when, you know, one of the reasons why I really love Provence is because it was subject to so many different influences. If you look at it here in this map, you can see it's in the south of France, and you have the influences coming in from Spain over the Pyrenees Mountains, and especially as things begin to heat up for Jews there. first at the end of the Visigothic period, which would be, you know, 6th-7th centuries. There's a lot of emigration from Spain into Provence. And then, of course, much later, when we get to the Inquisition in the 14th and the 15th century, you'll have a lot more Jews coming from Spain and bringing their ideas and especially their connection with Arabic wisdom and Arabic texts. Let's not forget that some of the greatest classics of this era were written first in Arabic, like Chovos HaLevavos, written in Judeo-Arabic, not written in Hebrew. We rely heavily on the translations that were made largely in Provence because this is where Hebrew-speaking Jews began to say, wow, these are really great ideas. Could you please like produce an entire volume of what Rabbeinu Bachya had to say or so on? You also have the influence of the great Ashkenazic centers to the north, a lot of the Bali Tosfot bringing their ideas down, which we discussed. And of course, you have the influence of the great eagle, Maimonides, that is making his way through the ideas brought to Provence and translated by the Ibn Tibbon family and others. All of these ideas are circulating around Provence, creating a new brand of scholar, the so-called Chachmei Provence, the sages of Provence, that brought a very different sensibility to the pressing issues of Judaism and of the human condition writ large. So that's one of the reasons I really love Provence. Now, when we look at our particular issue, the Aliyah of the 300 rabbis from Provence in France, Professor Ben Shalom brings examples of actual correspondence between this great leader, Rabbi Yonatan of Lunel, to Maimonides, such as this example here. And we see that one of the main elements in those conversations is regarding messianism. Rabbi Yonatan of Lunel is especially interested in what Maimonides has to say about a messianic movement that they hear occurred somewhere in the East. And it's interesting, he points out that the scholars of Provence had a pseudo-biography of Maimonides. It was already circulating within Maimonides' lifetime, and it was not an authorized biography, and it had a lot of incorrect things. But they had placed the messianic movement in the wrong area. But Maimonides did, in fact, deal with a messianic movement in Yemen. He wrote about it in his famous Igeris HaTeman, his letter to the Yemenites. And so Maimonides clarified for them, you know, what is messianism in Judaism? What is its role? How does it work? And so on. It's also very important to point out that there's a lot of other non-Jewish influences that are exerting themselves on the Jews of Provence. There is the possible influence of the success the Crusaders had in 1099, taking Jerusalem, of course, with great cost to the local population, Muslim and Jewish both. And then later, of course, the fall to Saladin, the collapse of the Crusader endeavor to the Muslims, that also inspired some messianic feeling among Jews, saying maybe this a harbinger of the eventual Messiah. All of this chaos, this war going on in the land of Israel. And the last thing that's especially important is the fact that Jews are spending a lot of time looking at the calendar. The Anno Mundi calendar, the calendar from creation that Jews follow to this day. It was not the only calendar they followed, but it was, you know, the classically Jewish one. Estimated that the end of the 5th millennium, right, the end of the years 4000 would occur in the year 1240. And a lot of Jews thought that that must be the moment when we would have a new messianic period. So all of these things come together and they're really exerting tremendous pressure on the sages of Provence, so much so that a large number of them, unlikely that it's 300, but nevertheless a large number of rabbinically educated individuals decide to leave Provence and make their way to the land of Israel. This particular Aliyah does not survive in large numbers. In the year 1219, less than a decade after they arrive, they find their homes destroyed because the nephew of Saladin, who was in charge of Jerusalem at the time, determines that the best way to protect the city from another crusader attack would be to ironically destroy the fortified walls so that the crusaders could not, for example, besiege the city, get inside, and then hold it. That the lack of fortified walls would mean that they wouldn't be able to hold it. So he destroyed those walls that specifically protected the French and the Provençal communities. They ended up trying to make space with the local Christian community. They were impoverished by this, and they went into a period of steep decline. This steep decline was partially reversed by the arrival of the great Nachmanides later on in the century, but it was never able to pick up and gather the kind of traction it had in the beginning of the 13th century. Nevertheless, it illustrates in a very powerful way the impact of the messianic idea in Judaism, its tenacious hold on the Jewish spirit, and the millennial draw of Zion, the idea that Jews are always going to look back to the land of Israel as their eternal homeland, and the hope that it will one day be once again the seat of a messianic kingdom. Okay, I hope you found this useful. It would be great if you took one of the last cabins that we have left. Actually, I'm not sure if the ship is totally full at this point. But if you can't join us, I'm looking forward to sharing with you some of my research and what I see when I'm in Provence later this year. Thank you very much for watching.